Hello and welcome back to The Lounge, the show that prizes off the grey plastic casing of electronic culture and takes a puzzled look inside. My name's Hari Kunzru, and in the next half an hour I'll be discussing the politics of Asian dance music with writer John Hutnick, experiencing solar radiation, among other things, with Joe Banks, also known as Disinformation, and doing a little TV DIY in SPAC, a new animation from Matthew Hall. But first, to those stalwarts of technoculture, Cold Cut. On The Lounge, we talk to a lot of people whose work is difficult to describe. And Joe Banks, who works as Disinformation, certainly falls into that category. The best I've come up with is poet of noise. I mean, most of us spend our lives trying to banish noise from signal, tuning in the TV or trying to hear that pirate garage station over the static. But Joe does things the other way round. Where you and I just hear noise, Joe listens to atmospherics from lightning and storms, biostatics, pylons, power loops, military signals, pulses of navigation systems, solar radiation, the list goes on. As Disinformation, he takes these phenomena and makes recordings and sound installations from them. Welcome to The Lounge, Joe.
Hi.
Okay, well, the obvious question is why?
I think probably the best way to describe my motive is that there's a sort of oversupply of experimental music and an undersupply of interesting sound art. There are far too many people sort of noodling about with bad music and sort of making funny noises for their own satisfaction or whatever.
But there's more than that to the noises you're hearing. I mean, part of the joy of it surely lies in their origins. I mean, how did you suddenly decide to start listening to the atmosphere?
Well, pretty much for those kind of reasons, is to try and create some form of experimental music that's much more specialised and sort of refined than the kind of usual guff that's floating around at the moment, as a way of just making it more, having an interest in that kind of area, but trying to create something that's much more distinctive than what people who are interested in that sort of thing usually see.
So how much of this, manipulation do you do? Do you tend to sort of produce the sounds, transmit them directly as you hear them, or do you do a lot of this tweaking and tinkering with them?
Well, I try to do less tweaking and tinkering because I think, generally speaking, there's been a sort of tendency to over-manipulate unusual sounds in experimental music, or perhaps the sort of art side being a slightly different area.
But certainly we're all used in kind of commercial techno music or whatever to hearing sound sources from all sorts of stuff that have been heavily treated.
Yeah. So. Well, I think people seem to respond to not treating material in that kind of way because the kind of effects that are generally used as treatments have become quite clichéd in themselves.
Right.
So it's quite refreshing to hear sounds that haven't been sort of processed to death, in a sense.
I suppose part of the fascination of this is that these sounds are part of our environment.
Yeah, I mean, I look at it as being, or like to look at it, or at least this aspect of the work has been a sort of form of electrical wildlife recording or something like that, as opposed to sort of musical composition. And fortunately, I've been able to get other people to sort of remix the sounds and stuff like that and sort of build them up into more musical structures. So there's sort of one group of records that I've put out that are sort of pretty much wildlife recordings, and another group that are musical compositions that have been put together by other people.
Right. I mean, you'd expect, I mean, this is a very relatively technical area of interest.
Yeah.
You know, and on your sleeves, you've got lists of kind of slightly scary sounding kit.
Do you
use a lot of very expensive equipment?
No, not
How specialised is this?
It's very specialised, but often it's very cheap, this equipment. It's not really technically too complex. It's really a case of the complexity lies in finding out about the material, gaining some kind of understanding of how to do it and what it is and what it represents. And so you sort of build up a picture of the sort of artistic potential of the material on the basis of its sort of intrinsic imagery, like, for instance, the connection between electrical storms and various types of sort of anthropological beliefs about religion and things like that.
Right.
It was a very potent area for artistic exploitation.
So, I mean, if somebody watching it at home wanted to listen to storms or to sunspots, one of these things, what's the cheapest way that they could, or the easiest way they could manage to
do generally that? Speaking, most of these effects manifest on AM radio as opposed to FM. FM was invented to suppress interference, and further than that, digital broadcast TV and radio have been invented to completely eliminate interference.
Right.
Though no doubt they'll generate new forms of interference of their own sporadically.
So you could tune in an AM radio, just a normal receiver.
it's a case of normally if you hear a sort of hiss or a crackle or something like that on the radio, you just kind of retune the radio a bit so that you can hear the music more cleanly. But it's a case of finding a quiet frequency, say, during a lightning storm or something like that, and listening to the effects that it produces.
So what have you got coming up?
A new remix CD, in fact. It's called Al Jabba, and it's been released on Ash International in a couple of months' time.